Hello everyone, welcome back to the Lightbringers podcast. Today we're going to be talking about a lot of things. It's going to be spears and homesteads, potentially. We will definitely do a more in-depth homestead stream in the future, but this will be a bit of both because we got spears and we got homesteads all in one bloody week. Good lord. Lots of things. We are excited. So excited, the rookery is stuck in a frozen time loop, touching their face through sheer excitement. Wow. I'm so excited.
I've been frozen in the moment of my extreme hype for all time.
And she's a ventriloquist.
And a ventriloquist, everyone. I apologize, everybody, if you are watching with the visual version of the podcast. I am just a placeholder image because today, Dawn Trail also came out in Final Fantasy XIV, and I've been going hard. So thank you all for having me in this frozen state while I also try to get a bunch of content ready and lined up and stuff with Dawn Trail.
So what can we, besides this picture, what can we imagine you look like right now in your full-on no-lifing Dawn Trail mode?
Yeah, I am wearing a Final Fantasy XIV Paisa t-shirt. I have a pair of yoga pants on because I did make myself do some yoga this morning since I was going to be sitting all day.
Yoga, good. Self-care, yes.
Yep, we love it. You can also thank one Dr. Griswold, who streams here on Twitch as well, for encouraging me to do the yoga this morning when I didn't want to and I just wanted to be a gremlin that did nothing but game all day. So yeah, self-care. Yeah. Gris self-care, I guess. And my hair is just clipped up. I have no makeup on and I look like a dark cave creature that's just emerged here for this podcast today. So
what you're saying is you still look 10 times better than I do.
Oh my gosh, no. Wow. You are majestic, you are glowing. But also, you are a new father, so I imagine the low sleep has been getting you. I imagine it's been getting you, so you're feeling
technically
tired.
Technically yeah. Agreeing with you, I guess.
No, I'm not.
We were just, there's explanations, there are layers to this.
No,
I don't care what any of you look like, goddammit. Because we're talking about Guild Wars 2.
I swear I did not mean it in that way. If you are feeling tired and worn down, mm-hmm. that's probably yeah, what that's, you find to yourself is what I mean.
That is not how I took it, but okay.
Okay, well, although I'd love to talk about how Boots looks today. Maybe we're going to talk about Guild Wars 2. Let's do a quick mini intro, very, very quick. What can we do?
Phonix, what do you do?
Phonix.
Hey, sorry, my avatar isn't working. We're having a great stream already. I'm Phonix, the Crichton Herald. Mm-hmm. I make content over on YouTube and occasionally stream here on Twitch. Please go and check out my video. I did a dive into what characters will be coming back for Guild Wars 2's adventures in Janthea Wilds. And it was a fun one. And one of the director of writers gave it a wink, so I might have got some things right. So yeah, go and check it out.
Oh damn! Okay, well,
Yeah.
Get your bingo cards ready.
Yeah, tinfoil hat time, people. Yep.
Oh yeah, I need hats.
Oh yeah.
Boots. What do you do, and where do you do it?
I change a lot of diapers. No, I've just finished up my what's it called?
Last Adventures.
The Last Adventures. They're all out now. Now there's 105 of them. After the Sodo, the final patch came out. So those are all done, and you know probably more will come out in the new expansion. So that adventure quest is never going to end. But I guess maybe I should start like going back to doing bad builds again. In the meantime,
Going around again.
Because there's no adventures to catch up on anymore. So I could do adventures as they come out to continue that, but that's not.
People enjoy the badness, which is also secretly not bad. Sounds good.
So I might do that, but you know, for the next 6 months probably, I might just not be able to do anything.
Do the things when you do it. Do it for the fun.
Exactly.
Do it for the enjoyment and the break.
And that's over at World of Enders on YouTube.
Wicked. Proof, what are you doing? Where are you doing it?
Hi, everyone. I've been posting quite a bit of Guild Wars 2 content over on my YouTube channel because there's just been so much to cover with Guild Wars 2 Jan through Wilds. Unfortunately, nice. I was not able to get to the Homesteads quite yet, but I hope we'll get some more information about that in the future, so that we'll be looping back around. But I actually just released a video about my first impressions regarding all of the spears, because I took the time and the pleasure to play every single profession yesterday, so I made a quick little video going over what I liked, what I disliked, and yeah, you can go over to my YouTube channel, check out the videos. I also stream here on Twitch on the weekends. We usually play Guild Wars 2 on Saturdays, and we're changing up for Sundays, and we are going to be doing some Final Fantasy 14 for some time, because, you know, I don't know if you guys heard, but there's another thing that's, you know, launched, so we're very busy.
Is it Head Start at the moment? Is it Head Start or is it launch?
Head Start, I believe. I think Rook could probably confirm.
I pre-ordered.
Oh yeah, it's early access. Yeah. So yeah, technically, the expansion releases July 2nd.
You were early access.
Rough.
Okay, not a fan of that. Not a fan. Okay, good. Croof, follow them. Do the things as well as Fornax and also Boots and also the Rookery as well. What do you do? Where do you do it?
Hello. Yes, I'm Rooker Rookery. That's R-O-O-K-U-R-I. If I'm not being a cave gremlin like today, you can find me live over on my channel, which is twitch.tv Rookery. You can find me on YouTube, where I'll be uawplaythrough reactions for Dawn Trail, which I'm recording outside of this podcast today, which is also Rookery. And you can find me on Twitter at Rookery _. We did go over live on stream this week the release, the sort of teaser video that they did about Homesteads, and we chatted about it, and I did my sort of first reactions to that, because I'm so blown away. It's gonna be like the best housing system in any MMO, and I'm so excited, and I know a lot of people are really, really hyped as well. So I'm looking forward to continuing to see what Janther Wilds has in store as we look ahead to that. I feel like we're all so blessed with a million MMO expansions this year, and a million games and all kinds of things. So hold on, everybody. It's going to be a good one.
It is. We've got lots going on. Excellent. Please go follow Rookery and doing all the things that they're doing. They're doing loads of hosting and casting as well. So please go and support them where they do that. Massively appreciate. And I am Jebro. I have also been releasing a ton of content on YouTube recently. Just did a little video on Homesteads and doing things around engineer and spears mostly, so I'm going to release some stuff over the weekend maybe about spear and engineer and what I think about that, because that's the main class I play. Otherwise, you've got the podcast episodes on here as well. Twitch.tv/JebroUni on a Friday at 1 p.m. Pacific ish, releasing them on Saturdays. And then you can also listen to us on Spotify, iTunes, all the things as well. So make sure you chuck a follow, chuck us a review as well. Massively appreciated. And yeah, don't forget as well, in the description below, you can also purchase the new expansion as well as a ton of Guild Wars 2 expansions as well, which are all about 75% off, I believe, at the moment. So if you want to use someone's links below, make sure you do that. Chuck it to your friends if they're going to purchase the expansion or you're getting anyone into Guild Wars 2. Massively support streamers through our all ArenaNet partners, and very much appreciate it, so please go and do that. Their links are all in the description below in the YouTube description specifically. Okay, hopefully this is gonna work as I go over to the game. Let's see, will it though? No, apparently not. Oh, actually, I'm just gonna do this other one because this is just gonna be easier, apparently. Fuck it. I swore. Damn! I swore already. And I failed. So, we have... What is everyone playing? We're playing spears first, peeps. We are going to talk about homesteads as we go. But we are going to be testing spears and giving you some gameplay footage. If everyone is okay seeing what they can see currently on the screen as well, let me know if there's any issues or anything else. But hello.
Exciting inventory wars going on. Very good.
Yeah, it is pretty exciting.
Prime just, gameplay.
I'm pretty
that is way better organized than any inventory I've ever had.
I mean, this is the beta character, so it's definitely better than mine.
Okay, wait, I'm here. I'm here in front of you. Come look at my character, my
you
beta character.
You have not given them any wardrobe at all. Like, what is going on?
Well, I just made it. I made it literally five... No, wait. What time is it? Half an hour ago, we're late.
That's the first thing I do.
We're late.
We're always late.
I'm trying to see...
I think you look so good, Boots. Just Thank like you. How good you look in real life. Just a
boy.
Oh, yeah.
And just, yeah, flawless.
Wait a second. That also is... It's also ambiguous.
This is good times.
So Boots will not let you breathe.
He will not. He will not let this. This will not go down in infamy, I think.
Now, do you care to share with the class what you've called your wonderful new character?
Well, I called my thief spear-wielding character, and I called it this because of a skill 3 on the thief spear, which makes me go, I can't... It's hard. I'll try to angle my character so you can see what's happening.
Sure. Do that.
Let's see. I gotta go this
go
way.
Go towards the training post. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm gonna go that way. All right. So, because of this skill.
Jesus. Oh, so it's like dagger 2.
Yeah. And so I called it Scooty McButt-Butt. That is my. That is my
That's why you called it Scooty McButt-Butt. Got you.
Also, it's also trying to evoke the visual of a dog rubbing their butt on the ground as they go along. If their butt, you know, feels itchy or something, they rub their butt as they scoot.
I'm very glad that you continued saying things and said after rubbing. I'm like, what are we talking about right now? I know I switched off of the stream for a sec because I was like busy like making my character, apparently. Oh, they didn't give us any infusions. Ooh. Okay. Thank you, Boots, for that.
You're welcome. You're
we welcome. Have myself on an engineer, Kruf is on an engineer, but it's actually a revenant. We have Fornax on an elementalist, we have Boots on a thief, and we have Rookery on a ranger. And we may switch about a bit as well. What particular specializations are we running, peeps? I'm running a holosmith right now. I'll let you say which ones. You're just running whatever it is. You
can on Vindicator, because I wanted to try like a hybrid power and condition damage build.
So you weren't cosplaying a dragoon?
Well, I'm that was the underlying reason, but I need to have some more solidified ideas behind this choice.
That's fair.
I'm gonna take us over to did they unlock dungeons in this for us?
I hope so. Yeah, we could probably go to a dungeon setting and show the skills.
Yeah.
Shit, hang on, what? No, well. What? I need a build then.
No, you've got it. You should have it. Everyone's got a build.
It's just core game dungeon content. No one is fine.
Yeah, for next, I'm not.
Crazy.
I'm not going wild with this.
I'm not even equipping utility skills.
Oh my god.
What?
We're just going to do story.
If you
don't know, yes. So that's because you talked to the new person. So if you are trying the beta at the moment, everyone, when you log into the game and you log into a beta character and you create it, you do not have to necessarily make a build or anything because there are traits and everything sorted for you in a very basic build. And the build I got for Engineer was actually pretty good. So I've just stuck with it. I have changed my
may or may not be optimized considering for some reason I do have carrion gear.
Yeah, so they've gone for
no,
mostly
it is optimized. Well,
the Aryan gear.
They've gone. Well, it's not. They've given you balanced stats. So they've given you a lot of the damage, but also just vitality, right? So it's just balance. It's just survival running around.
It's fine,
right?
It is fine.
I changed mine to Rampager, actually.
I also put down some tasty cakes next to the reinforced armor anvil. If you all want a little extra, like, what's that? Sweet. Tastes good.
Thank you so much, Kruf. I would love to have some of your cake.
Oh, God.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course.
I baked it just for you.
I am... I realized that when I went for... By the way, you can come into the natural dungeon if you want and start killing things.
Oh shit. Okay. Fine.
Oh shit.
Fine. Okay.
I'm just running into everything. I'm like, there's so many enemies. I want to kill them all.
All right. I actually have a question.
Sure.
I am commandeering this podcast. Jebro, I want to come to you first because I've also played the engineer. And I know you are an engineer main.
Yeah.
So I want to get a little insight as to how you're currently feeling with the NG spear from the trailer and from your experience playing it yourself.
I have really barely played it, but in terms of how it looks and everything else, I really love the trailer actually, because there's a skill here. The skills are, they say what, like light, very lightning-y focus, but it's burning, right? Like obviously lightning like brings burning with it, which is cool. I was gonna show a skill then, and then the cutscene happened. And you can't skip past this one. But not only is it that, but when you use your, I think it's your fourth or fifth skill, they still have these really big engineer themed animations as well. Like a cog comes up from the earth when you use one of the skills, which is really, really cool. Where is it? This skill, let me see. Fourth skill, I think it is. Yeah, so the cogs come up. It's very quick. But it's burning. It's a condition. So it's a condition weapon.
And doesn't it do like 725 defiance bar damage?
On the fourth skill, yes. Yeah, like whatever damage it is, depending on, you know,
I think that is the highest CC damage skill that we have ever seen.
Is it
really? The Willbender one is like 500 or something. Yeah. 400, 500.
It's a big cooldown as well. Oh, it's not that big, I guess. What is it, 15 seconds? Yeah, it's not that big, I guess. Maybe it's not that big. Yeah, it's cool.
That I am, blanket statement across the board, just obsessed with all the spears. Like, the way that they've realized them is so cool. I love how unique they feel. Even before we started the podcast today, as we were all getting into game, we were ooing and aahing over the animations for all of them and how distinctive and how unique they are. Like, I love the way that they did this. And we touched on it briefly, but I didn't actually fully say, but I'm doing Ranger. And like the Ranger Leap ability and some other stuff with it feels like I almost got a new elite spec, even though it's just a new weapon.
Oh, yeah.
Because anytime I use that ability, I'm just like, ah, that's so cool. And then the fact that some of the spears have things like that, you know, huge, you know, defiance bar damage or things like that, they feel like they're very practical and usable as well, which is really cool.
It's, I would agree with the whole statement of just they look awesome.
Yeah. I would say one thing they definitely did not skimp on this round of weapons is the animations for the skills.
They are loud.
They went all out with the animations. They're loud. Yep. I saw a clip or a picture of someone doing Deimos with a spear, with an elementalist spear, and the glyph or whatever it is for the elementalist thing that you put down, skill 5, was completely covering an oil.
Really?
So it was like impossible to see the oil.
Was it from there? That was from their point of view. Is that the same for everyone else though?
It's from their point of view. I don't know if it's the same for everyone else. Hopefully it's not the same for everyone else.
I don't believe it is, because I think for other people it will be cold away.
Yeah, that would make sense. But it's possible they may need to tone down some of the looks a little bit.
Or does it mean that they're bringing in options to bring that down?
I thought they already have options.
But maybe they're bringing in more.
Well, in a world in terms of the topic of visual effects, I actually love that they have gone more grandiose with these. And I hope that they don't cull them away to the point where they become essentially nothing to what they were. I would love to see maybe other fixes.
Look at that.
Yeah, that is, I think,
and gigantic.
I currently have effect LOD settings on, but I do have the setting where I can see my ally particle effects. I cannot see that glyph at the moment.
I can't see it either. So I can just see the shadowy edge. And for that as well, it's just water around the edge. It's just a water field. So you can see the field.
As long as it's just for you, then that's good.
Yeah.
That's all. Gigantic.
And then if you could make sure that you do have an option to tone down and it does actually work to tone down the visual effect of your own elementalist skill 5 on Deimos, then I think we're good. We're good in that
respect. Can you see, so with my spear then, can you see like the big lightning thing around me like that?
Yes, I see something above.
And now
I see a spear.
Did you see the electrical kind of storm?
I see. I see that.
Okay. Yeah.
It is a lot. It is a lot, but I think it looks too awesome, bad. I'm okay with it.
I actually don't. I've gone to the point where in Guild Wars 2, I've just accepted that that's just kind of the game. And, like, it just looks good and it's fine. Like, you know, sure, there's going to be problems with it in the future, but like people, they're still working out. Hopefully, they're bringing options. It's good. Like, I'd rather it be too much than too little right now, so they fade it down, right? Rather than like, oh no, we have to create more. Because at the end of the day, if you think about when they put an elite specialization or a new class into a game, that thing feels really, really powerful at first. And I think it needs, in Guild Wars 2, it's like, they want to make it feel powerful, but also look powerful as well, because it's the new toy, and then they'll work on, like, you know, all the things that they need to afterwards, probably.
Balance.
Which I don't know if they actually did for balance-wise in this beta. I feel visually, these guys are fun first, balance later, for sure. Visually, these are amazing. But I think that skill, like actual balance wise, they didn't go that way just yet. I think they still have some tweaking to do.
Oh no, yeah. I mean, I think this is going to be, they're looking forward to feedback now, and there'll be some like balancing done from this, but I don't know if this is going to be, Did they have two betas for the weapons before?
I don't think so.
No. We did have two betas, but only because they separated the elite specialization weapons, and then they introduced the new weapons.
Oh, that's that's right. So they did it for both. Okay. Fair. Is that? There's an ability which looks really. Is someone playing a mesmer? No, that's the Ellie one. What's that? Is that for air? The like really kind of looks really mesmery, like the air.
Oh, the purple air symbol.
Yeah.
I logged in and it was Weaver, but I like Tempest. I like to be support Healy because I'm a Kaba. Okay. And so I've just thrown together a build, which is probably completely pants. So, yes, I don't know.
Okay. I think I was talking more about the spear kind of like abilities for air. Like if they looked kind of that one there, that one, whatever that is, in the air.
They're very purple. If that helps.
Yes.
That's my deep analysis.
That's what I'm talking about.
They're fairly purple.
Just the general look of it. I'm doing like 2,500 to 3,000 burning on this.
Yeah, I think the elementalist effects. I also think they're really cool.
They look amazing.
I think they look amazing because it really feels to me like that is. Like, that is the fantasy of being an elementalist, right? And especially in a game that allows you to, use so many different weapons in a playstyle for a class. You're not just a magic wielder that has a staff. You can also be a magic wielder that has a spear. And the way that you weave the elements and use them with that will be different. And I feel like, for me, this is one of the first... I mean, I loved the catalyst animations and things with the kind of wells with the elemental creatures and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But this feels like one of the most dynamic visual weapons for me with elementalists, where I actually am like, whoa, like that's such a cool way to embody that in this weapon.
Yeah, just recently in your mind too, we have the pistol that came out, which it's like, this is a huge step up visually from the pistol.
Huge.
Mm-hmm.
I've really barely even touched the pistol, actually. I feel like I've still got so many weapons to try out and so many classes, which is cool because we're kind of getting all of these. It's a lot, actually. There's a lot of stuff. Like, we're getting a lot of stuff. Like, this expansion is
going to be ridiculous. Are you saying next expansion, they should not give new weapons?
No, keep them coming.
I mean, just maybe... I mean, but the thing is, if they didn't give us weapons, like what would, like, we're running out of stuff that they can give us for expansions, aren't we? Like all of the features and stuff that this could have to be, like, this expansion, I'm sorry, But like at the moment, like going off weapons for 2 seconds, and then we're gonna come back because I don't want to. Like, how are they gonna? They're bringing raids back, I mean, and bringing houses in, and they did spears in one expansion.
I think that particular question is a great way to start thinking about predicting when or if a Guild Wars 3 might come.
Oh.
I think it's like, how many more years of expansion do you have in your head that could give features in your imagination that, like, through any of your imagination, can you think of features that could come in expansions that doesn't, like, put a hat on a hat?
Yeah, I mean, maybe you don't necessarily need... I'm going to be very careful about this because that's something we could talk about, but I'm going to bring us back to spears, and it's my fault. It was my fault, Boots. It was my fault.
Yeah, I want to bounce off of what Rook was saying for a quick minute with these particular weapons in terms of the visual effects, and then also just gameplay in general. We've been talking about the visual elements, and I really want to key in on Elementalist in particular, because this is the first time in many years, probably since Heart of Thorns, where I feel like they've really showcased and given a lot of love to class fantasy for some of the professions. Elementalist, for the past few editions, have received a lot of melee weapons where their magic was more so infused into the strikes, and you didn't get that sense of a caster. But with this, they really allowed it to play into that long-ranged raw magic fantasy. And I just hope that they continue to prioritize class fantasy in the game, because we've seen a lot of it been stripped away due to balancing reasons with boons and unique effects. But I think one area they could really continue to lean into is in that visual department. And when you compare it to Soto, and this expansion, I think they've learned that with the spears, and they've done a much better job at executing class fantasy.
Yeah, honestly, I would be so okay thinking about tying like those two things together almost, right? The idea of how successful the class fantasy of spears has been, but then also the idea of what could they do in future expansions in Guild Wars 2. If they were to at some point release an expansion that was almost like kind of a focus on your own powers or your own ability and accumulation of power, and give us some extra lore and additional things about all of the classes that we're playing, but then maybe at that time as well go in and even, you know, touch up some of the animations or the fantasy of other weapons and things without having to, you know, release all new elite specs or things, or they could too if they wanted. I honestly think that's something that players would be really invested in Guild Wars 2, because oftentimes at the start of the game, you pick up, you know, whatever class that maybe somebody has suggested to you to play, and then, you know, you might switch, you might change that playstyle, you might pick up an elite spec because your raid group needs something, or you might want to experiment with different weapons. But I think one area that, while the gameplay has always been really fun in Guild Wars 2, I think that connection to the class you're playing and what it means to be that class as your character, right? Like, if I navigate the world as an elementalist, what does that say about my character? What does that mean for my fight? What does that mean for my legend as, you know, whatever hero I am? Is something that has maybe always felt a little bit more abstract because it hasn't been, you know, a huge part of the narrative or other things, although they've given you some little tidbits about it here or there. But I really like that these spears are showing us more of that kind of, you know, what is the way that you operate and fight, and how do you feel when you do that? Because Guild Wars 2 has great examples of that, but I think this batch of weapons in particular really feels distinctive for each of the different classes, which was good because I think people were worried, oh, hey, well, if everybody just gets spears, is it going to be really samey? But it's definitely not, and I love that.
Yeah.
Boots, move your ass.
I'm sorry, I may or may not have Scooty McButt-butted myself off a bridge.
Oh no.
Again?
Okay, there's quite a bit of mobility on the Thief Spear.
Good point. The spears suck, they're so basic, it's boring. What? What are you talking about, Gamble? What are you talking about, dude? Have you played it? Are you joking? You're joking. Are you memeing?
He's joking. Yeah.
Even touching a bit more on the gameplay, I find that there are a few spears across the professions that look to explore a different mechanical niche that they haven't before. Taking Ranger, for example, which Rook is currently playing, the spear, fifth ability, actually gives you a stealth effect. And that stealth allows you to enhance your other spear attacks. And stealth is not something that you see a lot of emphasis on Ranger. It's there in a couple abilities and effects, but to have something completely new on the Ranger, which is in line with its class fantasy in terms of blending in with nature, camouflage and whatnot, and then adding that on top of a new weapon and changing the abilities, I think that was a really good gameplay addition as well.
I just did 8k burning on the tick. Like, that was wild. What the fuck? Sorry. Yeah.
So, I wish I was doing Connie damage. I'm playing Revenant Spear, so.
Well, I really
love it, but it's not good.
I really like that it's Condi. The fact that it's one Condi as well. Well, it's not one, it's bleeding as well, right? And also vulnerability, I suppose, technically.
You
and
get to
cripple.
Maybe switch off pistol if you want to be Condi.
Yeah, right. That's it. It is really solid. But as I'm playing Holosmith, I'm like, I'm not just sitting in Holosmith all the time. I know I've got grenade kit as well, but like my actual damage abilities are good, like are actually like, you know, as I switch through them, it feels like I may rotate towards them with actual intention rather than just using pistol 4 or just 2. Like, you know, there's a blast there. There's like 6 stacks of burning on this Devastator skill, on the focus one anyway. And there's lots of, it feels like Holosmith a bit because you've got the different kind of so if you've got the focus skill up from, what is it, Lightning Rod or whatever it was, you basically can do extra damage or extra, you know, CC, etc., depending on the target you hit. So it kind of feels like a little bit like Hollowsmith, Photon Forge Heat, where you can do extra amount of damage or something lasts longer because of the amount of heat you've got. So it's really like it's pretty flipping awesome, actually. I'm playing it now, like, this is a lot of fun. Like, I'm zoning out a little bit on it, which is good because that means I like it. It doesn't mean it's good for the podcast though. We can probably exit here because it's just the flipping last boss and you're literally not touching it. You just run balls into it. So
speaking of balls,
Revenant.
Show the balls.
No, I'm logging out.
Shall we showcase the Revenant balls real
wait,
fast?
Jebro,
oh, you want
balls.
Me to
balls.
You wanted to go to the
orbs. We must ponder them.
We'll come back to
Lion's Arch.
Sorry, I forgot about the balls.
But I guess this is a nice time to I'm not a Revenant main by any means. However, I have been playing a bit of Revenant Spear, because I actually really enjoy the class fantasy of it. It's this dark red abyssal ink spell effect, and I think it's really cool. But I've gone to the Reddit, and it seems that my sentiments are shared. The Revenant Spear, from my gameplay with it, it's so slow, and I don't know why.
Is it powerful,
I really don't know why.
Or is it just like...
No, because it's so slow.
Is there not like a big damage? Like, do you not get big damage from it, even if it's slow?
No.
Oh, okay.
Because it's a condition based weapon. So with Condi based weapons, you kind of want to stack
build.
Up.
Yeah. It's building.
You kind of want to stack up those conditions fairly quickly to get
balls?
A big, you know, burst of damage. All right. So here are the.
Sorry. Like, if you're not watching this, like, you know, you need to be watching this video. I'm sorry. Show me the balls from Revenant.
So these are the Revenant balls.
Okay. What are they doing on the
They will do damage and they inflict slow and chill.
Okay.
So it's like a crowd control-ish effect.
You have to be daring to use these balls.
Yes, you do.
They're very spy game.
They are. Safe word, please.
Really cool. Really cool effects on the orbs. But when playing Revenant, it's just such an odd choice to have such slow attacks on a kit where your entire focus is to upkeep this buff on yourself. Oh, this is the fifth ability. This is like your core attack. You use this ability to gain a stack on yourself, a buff, and your key premise is to always be using this. It's a very slow attack. It
has
a very small radius, but it does not refresh all of your individual stacks if you use it. So they will numerically individually drop off after 8 seconds. Yeah. So on top of the slow attack animations with all of your skills, and because it's condition based and that they all drop off and they don't all refresh when you successfully strike an attack, the damage is really low. The pace of Revenant Spear is really slow. But that being said, I actually really like this kit.
Interesting. Okay.
Do you think if it was a little faster, what if you had quickness? Would that help?
No, it just feels like a normal weapon at that point. It just feels like you're like, it's weird because when you have quickness, it feels like you're attacking at a normal pace that any other profession would attack. Mm. So it doesn't really feel like you're benefiting from quickness.
So it's kind of like Firebrand feels without quickness, because quickness is built into a Firebrand. So. It feels like since Firebrand came out, since that expansion, it feels like everything's been designed with quickness in mind as having already been on the character.
Which is really unfortunate, I think.
I know.
Where do you limit other people's effects? Am I like looking in the right place?
Oh, so I can't remember. As a PSA, if anyone is interested, you can go to your graphics, and there's a under the graphics tab, there is an effect LOD checkmark at the bottom of advanced
settings.
Oh,
it's just that one. Yeah.
But you also, in the general options, if you go down to groups in the general tab at the very, very bottom, you can hide all effects. You can only show party, you can only show squad, or you can show all of the effects as well.
Wait, where is that? In group?
In general.
In general. Okay.
At the very bottom, which is weird that it's a graphical setting under general and not graphics.
Oh.
But this is bugged because it will actually hide raid effects that you need to be aware of. It'd be great if they patch that, because this is the one reason people don't use this, because it is bugged.
Can you use that fifth skill again for me, Kriff, just to see if it is different on my screen?
It will hide it, probably.
Oh no, that is bigger now, the particle effects. Okay, so can maybe, I had them limited. That is bigger now. Right, yeah, okay, yeah. Now it's doing it properly. Yeah. I've had that on for PvP for so long. I've just like completely forgotten that it even exists. Where is Grand Herald? We get you bet over here. I want to see that like lightning now. So actually it doesn't matter, because it means that you can reduce it. So that is good. So you can reduce it significantly. It is significantly reduced. But yeah, I was complaining for a second about the fact that Revenant skill didn't look very impactful or good. And now it actually looks great. Good. Yeah. Okay, good. So I don't think that is a question.
Want to hear about Thief?
Sure, yeah. Let us know. What do you think?
So I've been using Thief for about a half an hour now.
Sure. Lots of experience.
And number one, you know, the Scooty McButt skill is pretty damn cool.
Nice.
And so basically the weapon is designed so that you kind of are trying to bring back lead attacks and follow-ups and finishers that they used to have, but into Guild Wars 2. And there's two skills on the set that do them. It's skill 2 and skill 3. Skill 2 is all Condi focused.
Yeah.
And skill 3 is more utility focused, I would say. So skill 3, the chain of... You could like switch back and forth between the two of them to do one lead skill from one of them and a follow-up skill from the other. Skill 3 is, you know, this guy, you do that.
Yeah.
But also the follow-up is like a really good chunk of healing. It's it's a life siphon of, on my thing, it says 1600 and 2400 life siphon healing. So yeah, that's a pretty decent chunk of healing for a follow-up skill. And then the finisher does a lot of damage and then turns you invisible.
Oh, nice.
Which obviously we all know is good for a lot of things as a thief. You can do your stealth attack on the spear, which is also a Condi stealth attack, gives bleeding and poison. And it looks like it gives you initiative.
Oh, okay, it cool. Does.
Yeah, if it follows a finisher skill, it gives initiative. So that, like, I have not been hurting for initiative doing this on my build. I've been going lead attack with the Condi one, the skill 2, follow up with the skill 2 for more damage, Condi damage, and then finishing always with the stealth to go back to the stealth attack, and that stealth attack does a lot of Condi damage, and you get your initiative back. And the skill 2 and 3 don't use very much initiative to begin with. I think the lead attacks are both 3, and then the follow-up and finishers are both only 1, so you never start for initiative doing that.
Nice.
Probably a rotation for PvE will end up being mostly just spamming skill 2, but then every once in a while spamming skill 2 and then doing a finisher in 3 and then the sneak attack, the stealth attack, to get your initiative back. So like doing a balance between the two of those.
But you'll also want to prioritize 4, because that does give you a very nice damage buff if you use
Yeah, 10% Condi buff.
Finisher. Boost. And then if you use that after a finisher, use the 4, it then triggers 2 and 3. It acts as a lead attack.
It acts as a lead attack. So, yeah, and it only is 2 initiative instead of 3. So if it's a lead attack, then you stay of initiative.
There's a lot of combos going on with Thief. It's like, yeah. You want to do 2-2-2? You want to do 2-3-2? 2-3-3-4? Into 3-2-2, whatever.
The only thing about it is that it you would only probably be using it every 10 seconds, because that's the amount of time for the 10% bonus damage buff wears off, because it itself doesn't do any Condi damage as opposed to the other lead attacks.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Okay.
But I will just say one thing about this. It does seem like it has a lot of healing, self-healing built into the spear, which is something that haven't seen a lot of on a thief.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So that is interesting. It might be an interesting dueling weapon.
I played Thief yesterday, and it was one of my top two, I would say.
Wait. What was it your was top very fun. For Thief?
Yeah, Thief is nice. Very surprisingly. I really enjoyed it. It was just a different mindset when you're playing Thief, because usually I just spam my abilities, but I became so much more interested in how I actually comboed my skills together, which was a nice change for Thief.
Awesome. Okay, Thief, fun so far. Okay, how was Ranger and Elementists for Rook and Fornax? How you feeling? Jesus, that is Fornax. Huge.
Fornax, you go. You talk about Elementalists.
Oh, gosh, thank you. So,
and it doesn't have to be high-end, it's just like, are you having fun?
Well, the numbers here, if we see the modifiers.
Okay, you can all take the piss, because you know that I'm totally shit when it comes to builds, and it's fine.
I didn't.
It's not my wheelhouse. I'm okay. You can all take the piss out of me. So, my first character in the game ever was an elementalist, and chose it purely because I loved, and it was actually a Silvari elementalist as well, and it's because I purely loved the spell effects. There was this Phoenix effects on the scepter, and I was like, okay, I'm sold, I'm doing it. Mm-hmm. And I spent like most of my like first 4 years in the game being on the floor as a dead elementalist, but I was happy because it was very pretty. And this feels fairly stable, and I like that for a simple-minded girl like me, the skills are very logical through the different elements. So you
have self-deprecation in your paragraph so far is very on is very like
it's peak.
Is peak.
just peak.
I'm gonna ask you to.
Is it more peak than me stop. Saying I look disgusting?
Oh my god. kind language. Enable kind language to self, please, people.
Okay, so it's very straightforward. So the first skill is a straightforward basic damage. The second skill is a modification to that damage. So it adds a burn, or it adds some sort of cripple, or it adds something depending on the element that you're in. Yeah. The third skill is a ground drop effect, which is meteorites, or it's electric, or... And the next skill, what does that do? Sorry, the third skill does something. It's a boon to you. So you'll get super speed, you'll get that kind of thing. And then the next two is a ground targeted damage. And then the big showy skill that's a massive glyph that apparently is the red mage... a break bar of the game. If you play 14, you'll know exactly what I mean. It kind of messes up mechanics because it takes up so much space, you can't see anything.
Or nice. I love the fact that you chose like the most complicated class to try to describe.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're doing a very good job. You're doing a very good job. You're just giving us a general rundown. Very good. Yeah, I appreciate it.
And I will say that having played for a whole however long that we have been online, it feels very stable. I didn't feel as squishy as I normally do, and they've given me quite, there's no toughness or anything on the set that they've given me in this character, so it's and anyone who plays an elementalist will know how delicate and easily we bruise like a peach, so it was fairly fine to just run in and just blast off, and I felt fairly confident. I do have a few utility skills like Arcane Shield to kind of mitigate, but it felt fun. I liked the spear. I loved the Paragon in the original games. Anything that kind of gets that vibe is perfect with me, and I'm hoping that I can experiment with support, which is what I love to play. I like to tank, I like to support, so that's my bag.
Nice.
I want to say something about Weaver real quick with the spear.
Oh yeah.
Can we ask Rook what they felt about Ranger first, and then maybe you can talk about that after?
Yeah, I have a couple of things I want to say actually. Yeah, go ahead.
No, honestly, like Fornax, I'm right there with you. I am not, you know, the kind of player that is a big sweaty boy calculation number kind of person. But honestly, I think that between
what are you trying to say about me, Jebro?
I'm sorry.
Show me your numbers, darling. Yes.
I'm not like these, you know, no beautiful life. Bald people with their new children and their dummy caked up butts.
Yeah.
Vomit on the show.
Please refer to a few podcasts back where Kruv talked about having to go a little bit less hard on their lower body workouts.
Hard on the lower body.
Workout.
I can't fit into my swim trunks anymore.
Too thick, I'm saying. Sorry, everybody. But the joy and beauty of this podcast, other than all of us being utterly absurd, is also the fact that I think we bring a lot of different perspectives. So again, to like enjoy something like a new weapon, you don't have to be somebody that's out there looking to, you know, optimize stuff and find this perfect best in slot and all sorts of things. New weapons bring even new ways to connect with, or as we were talking about earlier, to realize class fantasy. And I've seen a lot of people talk about this, both in chat and even when I've been, you know, streaming, or people were talking even on Discord about the spears and how a lot of folks are finding a niche that they enjoy. And I feel like this Ranger spear gives that, right? I do agree that I think there's a really fun fantasy with kind of being the hunter that's working with your pet to take things down. And I love that that five ability gives you that stealth option. Then with some of the even like flanking or stuff, you know, where you can try to get into a strategic position, you can toss down this net, you can empower those other skills so that you and your, you know, your companion, your animal companion, lunge out from the shadows to attack the prey that you've ensnared. And I think it's really fun. It's a simple thing, but even having a weapon that allows you to kind of, you know, interact with itself in interesting ways, like that stealth changes those abilities, like to me that keeps it really fun and interesting, and it makes me want to kind of engage with that more. And I also really like that I think it has a nice balance, right? There's a few things you can use with like your three that's ranged, and then it applies some of that CC with the cripple on it, so you can kind of from range fling that spear in if you want. Then you can kind of, you know, pop stealth, leap in with your pet, do some of those AoE hits, things like that, right? So I think it has a nice synergy within itself, and it, nice. Like, definitely makes me feel, you know, like I said earlier, that it's a different fantasy for Ranger, but that is really satisfying to play with a new weapon.
Wicked. Awesome. Well, just bear in mind as well, we are going to talk about Homesteads, and I'm going to ask, do people want to play and talk about Homesteads, or maybe we look at the video and we talk about it a little bit in depth, because I'm not sure we're going to do a podcast
the video, right?
Episode.
Yeah, the video would be...
Yeah, I don't think we need to play everything and, like, play all the things. I really like your point there, Rook, about the interplay between different skills on the weapons, because you don't have utilities, etc. So they're trying to do that with all weapons. And I just noticed on the Mesmer, like if I hit a specific ability and I pour onto an enemy, like it lowers the cooldown of one of my other abilities or refreshes it, for example. And there's like some healing, some support. There's also a blur on here as well. And I'm like, oh, this seems like a really decent PvP weapon, right? Like, and if you had to switch over to like sword and shield or something like that, might be cool on Mesmer. But like, I mean, I know people in chat are like saying it's awful and this other stuff, and I'm just like, I think that maybe from maybe a different point of view you might be speaking from, but so, I think generally, like, from first impressions, sheerly off of first impressions, like, they're fun right now. And that's one of the most important things, I think, for me at the moment anyway. But like, we're not talking high level ridiculous balancedness, like, we're not talking about numbers. Yeah. I think it's important, like, the abilities have to be fun and impactful, and you know, the looks have to be important. That's why, you know, obviously they've got a couple of months till the expansion comes out. They can adjust numbers and stuff, but like in animations, so, they can quicken up, I guess, as well.
So, but I think that the people who are saying that have they have a point in that. It's something that I want to discuss a little bit, actually, because there is a difference between whether a weapon set feels fun and cool for different game modes or what you're trying to use it for. So the PvE, these might be designed for PvE more than for PvP, because a lot of these weapons have like an intricate system built into them. Like for Thief, they got the lead attacks. For Revenant, I think they have a system built into it. Elementalist, they have a huge system built into it. And the more complicated you make a weapon, the more interesting and fun it is for PvE.
Yeah.
But for PvP, the more complicated and probably in a lot of cases less fun it is. Because in PvP, people like to have skills available that are straightforward and easy to use so that they could use them when they need to use them at a certain time. If there's like a really complicated system built into the weapon in order to get to certain skills or in order to fully optimize the weapon, it's very hard to do in PvP, which makes it a worse weapon for PvP. So it's possible that not all these weapons. I know Warrior is a very simple weapon. Warrior Spear is a simple weapon. That's why a lot of people are really enjoying Warrior Spear in PvP. Yeah. So I think that that's the trade-off, right? Like, some of these were designed to be a little more complicated, more interesting for PvE than they are for PvP.
For sure. But there is some definite, like, even just Engineer Mesmer, just looking at those skills, there was a lot of skill where I'm like, damn, this would be like a shed load of fun in PvP. But like you say,
there's definitely also a fact that we're only been doing this beta for a couple of days now, right?
Yeah.
So it takes time to learn a weapon, and if a weapon is complicated, it takes a lot of time to learn a weapon. Mm-hmm. And so in PvP, that learning curve is very tough. So I think maybe eventually when people get a real good handle of the way a weapon works, it will actually end up being fine and really fun in PvP, like the Mesmer, like Elementalist possibly in the future. But it's also possible that right now it's just not balanced properly to be that great in PvP.
Yeah, and when it comes to the topic of balance, these things always change. From one moment we're like, oh, this is great, and then a year later, we come back and revisit numbers, and we're like, oh wait, it's been nerfed to oblivion, and it's no longer viable. So sometimes the conversation of balance can be a little, you know, just not as... For a first impression, I would say it's not as important, because these things will innately change with time.
Yeah.
But...
I will say, I remember the dialogue around Catalyst Hammer was very rough when it first came out. Everybody was like, this is way too difficult to use. It's not very good in PvP. It's never going to be good. And then Catalyst had like a long period of time where it was the best class to use in PvP for a while. So, you know.
It's, like people like are really, really loud. First, and then they start to get used to it, and then, you know, this has been a long time coming, but I think people just need to remember that if you're going to give feedback, be critical, but be respectful, and don't say like, this is going to be rubbish and blah blah blah, and like, here you go, here's no feedback. Like, it's just childish. People just need
one
to
point of up. Feedback I would like to give though is on top of the fun element that I think we're all hitting on, especially for most players, because they don't really get into the minutiae of min-maxing numbers and the statistics and everything. And I think overall, you want to go for that fun element. However, I would like to see almost all of these spears buffed. I would much rather have a new product lean more powerful and exciting to play from that element and from that side, rather than a new product launches and it is very underwhelming. And then it just kind of leaves everyone with a bad taste because this is supposed to be new. So,
engineer feels like pretty strong though.
There are some professions.
Yeah, some of them are very strong, some of them are less.
I'm playing Necro now, and I'm like
what?
Elementalist is, I think, if we're talking numbers, Elementalist does need a lot of buffs. I would like to see that buffed up quite a bit. Things like Revenant, Ranger,
yeah.
I think maybe Warrior as well.
That kind of thing, like, you know.
That's what this beta is for.
I mean, I think it's just general impressions as well. But like numbers, like, yeah, I mean, that's what it's for. People say, I mean, as long as like I said, like, as long as the skills are there and like the skills feel good, etc., etc., like, numbers are easy to adjust. That's like the easiest thing they can do.
It can be easy, but it's a matter of that matter of time having to wait for balance patches to hit, and sometimes. That 3 month, the 3 to 6 months when an expansion first launches, you want to have the impressions be as good as possible. So yeah, I'd much rather them tune them down rather than having a waiting period of needing to tune them up.
Oh yeah, I mean, they've still got ages. They've got a while till this comes out anyway.
First impressions, though.
I'm loving, like, this Necro Spear is fun as hell. It actually feels pretty, like, easy to play, like, compared to, like, the Mesmer and the Engineer, like... It's got a port, which is fun.
I don't. Okay, so chat. How are we feeling about Necromancer?
I'm actually not minding it.
I don't. I was a little bored with it.
It's not as complicated.
From a theme,
absolutely.
No, it's more complicated than Greatsword. I'd say for the theme of Necromancer in particular, this is the one profession out of all of them where I feel like they dropped the ball. Very similar to Greatsword. It feels like a lot of what we've been receiving for Necromancer in terms of power-based damage and a lot of lifesteal. I don't feel like... It's just... When we're this deep into expansions and weapons, I'm like, where's the newness? Where's the Minion Master? Where are the summonings? Where's the death magic? The bones? It just did not land. It was the only one. And it was shocking because I was like, oh, Necro's usually always really... you know, well ahead of the game and has shown a lot of love, but Necromancer, I was
about time
impressed.
I'm still kind of enjoying the I mean I would have to play this in PvP and other modes, but like, you know, just jumping onto it, but I get what you're saying about the newness. Like, there is the sense of, like, you know, the second ability is very similar to just the axe too, and the third, yeah, like, the only other thing that's different maybe is the port.
They have a unique debuff though, so I'll give them props for that. They did add a completely unique debuff to
this
the spear.
This is all about burst though. This is all about burst and immobilizing and there's some nice CC on there though. So it's got immobilize and stuff, so there is difference there, but I see what you mean. I do enjoy the port though, that's very fun. I don't know. I think I'm kind of, I need to play more.
Can I circle back to the elementals for the Weaver, the thing that I wanted to say?
Sure, and then we'll talk about Homesteads for a bit.
So for Weaver, the difference between the rest, obviously you get all those, the third skills for Weaver, the combination skills. The interesting thing about that is the third skill for all the Weaver skills has an actual line there that says recharges the cooldown of your primary attunement. So I don't know if you guys know how Weaver works. The cooldown of attunement swapping on Weaver is down to 4 seconds, but they all go on internal cooldown every time you swap attunements. So what it does is when you press that button right after you swap, you could double attune to your primary attunement. That's cool. It like makes it so that you don't need to use Unravel as a utility skill ever, but nobody really used Unravel anyway, so it doesn't really matter. So it basically replaces a utility skill that nobody really used, which I guess makes the question, what is the value of that? And the value is, it's undetermined right now. Maybe it's going to be useful in the future in some ways. People will figure out a way to use it properly. But I will say, a way to make sure that those third skills had value is if instead of it recharging the primary attunement, is if it recharged your secondary attunement. So you could swap back into the attunement you just got out of.
That sounds really good, Boots.
Yeah.
So that might be a bit more of a higher level conversation, but I see what you're saying.
It might break things in the game because there's a lot of traits in the game that say when you swap to the attunement, this thing happens. But it also has a little line that says this doesn't happen if you're double swapping into the attunement. So, yeah.
But if you go back to the attunement, you wouldn't necessarily be double swapping. You would just be.
That's what I'm saying. Going back into the old attunement, that would be great because those would work. But the way it's working right now is it doesn't trigger any of those traits.
I don't think it would cause any problems. Because it would just, so if you were in water, fire, and then you swap to fire, you use that ability, you'd be able to go back to water.
Yeah.
So you'd just be back into water, fire.
Yeah, it would be bad. It would be maybe slightly overpowered for one thing, which is stone heart weavers.
It could.
Yeah. Anyway, that's all. That's all.
We're going a little bit further right here. Maybe that could be a video that you make.
On the topic of build, I do see why they are going in this direction is because the weaver has a trait when you are fully attuned to an element, you gain a damage buff. So
yeah.
Probably making it much easier and more accessible for the spear to not have to worry so much about min-maxing, you know, cooldown numbers, and they just easily slot into that.
That's right. It's an 8-second buff, though.
Yeah.
Amazing. As I play the Necro Spear, I actually start to enjoy it even more. I'm sorry. I'm getting the vibe of this weapon, though. This is like a movement. This is about like roaming around the map, like with just one weapon without using even swiftness and stuff, and like going into Reaper Shroud. Like the combination of things is really fun. And like the thing with Reaper is, I think, you know, unlike Engineer and whatnot, is remembering like the potential weaving abilities that you have and capabilities to do that. So like if I'm in the necro running around the world, I can use port to get around, and then I can just pop into shroud, use my second ability, get somewhere else, hook onto this enemy, boom, I'm on, then I can kill them. I can build as I'm doing that, I need to keep hitting things because I need to keep building up the shards, right? So I can keep healing myself and keep fairly like stable, and as you're doing that, like, you feel like unstoppable. It's kind of, I kind of like it, actually, honestly. But yeah, like, each to their own, right? Like, it really depends on what you're doing. Would this be boring after a while? Potentially, I don't know, but like, I don't know, I find that kind of fun. Yeah, I might be, I guess, it doesn't matter really. But anyway, yes, Nanite cousin, nephew, sorry, you're not my cousin. Okay, we're gonna go on to Homesteads. I really wanna play more of this. I really love the main class wise, Engineer was sick. So fun. The amount, the numbers helped. And I'm just like, whoa, AK burning, baby. Give me that burning. I did try a bit of Mesmer yesterday, which was fun. I've still gotta try the other ones. Guardian looked cool, whoever was using, I think that Kreef was. That just looked good. Honestly.
The Guardian effect that you were putting down, Kroof, might be one of my favorite Guardian visuals in the game. Like, it's so cool. A lot of the Firebrand effects are really neat, but like that one, like that ground glyph thing that's like a little sun speary, but a little, I don't know. It's so cool.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I saw that one.
It's right. Beautiful. I highly recommend Guardian Spear.
Can you do it for me in a sec when I come back over?
Oh, I logged out.
Fine. It's okay. Let's talk about Homesteads. All right, everyone can see it later. Right, so I'm going to jump into
chat.
This
wants housing. Housing.
It's okay,
housing.
It's okay, so do I. Fine. Right, so we had, I'm just going to get the video and stuff up. Now, first of all, this was a major win PR-wise for Guild Wars 2. A huge video. exclusive to PC Gamer, which is a huge, PC Gamer is massive, right? And like, in terms of like just being around for so long, it's like one of the oldest PC publications there is out there. And they gave them exclusive look, and the video is very good. Like, it's ridiculously good, in fact. I think this could be one of the best videos they've released. Like, just, I don't know. I'm gushing.
We should get
a bit.
That reviewer to be a ReNet partner.
He is what the chief executive of the UK, like UK editor in chief. This is a pretty big wig person over in PC Gamer in UK. So like,
and they kind of seem like they've played Guild Wars 2 in the past, at least.
Yeah,
they knew what they were talking about. I agree.
I also love the new Final Fantasy 14 shade that they liberally threw at every opportunity.
Oh, I did as well. I enjoyed that a lot. I was so like, yeah, good. 14 housing is nothing compared to Guild Wars 2.
Listen, I love 14 and I love 14's housing, but that housing system has so many problems that they have still never addressed. And it makes it difficult to engage with it because, you know, you have to learn all these weird clipping, glitching things to move items where you want. And you have to do all this weird stuff to, like, get things placed. And you have to also fight for your housing plot. There's a lottery system. There are only so many houses and only so many types of, like, the big houses that people can get. And not even, like, I would be shocked if even 1% of the player population is capable of getting a large house in the game because of how few there are. Like, it's it's wild. And, like, I love seeing what people create in 14 with it. They have gorgeous furnishing items. And I love seeing what people create in other games too, like ESO, where really they avoid a ton of those issues. You can have all kinds of houses, you have instanced houses, you can free place things, but then you get into this whole other aspect with ESO, with the cash money that has to oftentimes be poured into it. Like, you can do housing without that, but it is 1,000 times more arduous. It takes a ton of in-game money, resources, all kinds of things, a ton of hours of just running around to try to pick up one thing or find this thing at a vendor that you have to run halfway across the map to. So again, when they started this video and they said Guild Wars 2's new housing system may very well be the most player-friendly housing system that exists in MMOs, they then just went on to show that it genuinely looks like it's going to be. Yeah. Yeah, and it's amazing. Like, it's so cool, the things they put into this.
So let's start off, like, by... The video is going in the background. If you're not watching the VOD, we've just got the video kind of circling in the background and whatnot. So if you don't know how housing is going to be in Guild Wars 2, housing in Guild Wars 2 is called Homesteads. You get to have a instance, which is your personal instance. It is your personal instance, but it's with the expansion. And this is going to be a mastery track that you level up through the expansion, Gemfear Worlds. So it's specific to that. So you're going to have to own it to have it. at the moment. They may change that in future, you never know. This is separate to your personal instance, and it's separate to your guild hall, and it's a completely new crafting line as well, which is actually where we are. Sorry, go on, Boots.
I was going to say, that also kind of like gives me ideas that possibly in future expansions, like they had new guild halls in old expansions, they might be able to just carry over the system to a new homestead,
game. Like in ESO, for example, they do that. So like when you get a new zone, normally there's a new house.
So I think that's very possible here.
Yeah, but you have to pay an extortionate amount of money in games like ESO.
But it sounds like they won't have to do that this time.
I hope not. But I do think that... I think it's good that they've locked it behind an expansion, if I'm honest. To a degree, I would like maybe a small instance for players to have when they start playing the game, just to give it a bash, give it a try, maybe. But like, it's good because they're actually making it as a feature which you have to pay for, and it's not like it's extortionate, right? Like in the ESO, I am not even joking. Like some of the best homes are like $150 plus. That is not me exaggerating. Like it is legitimately that much money, and it's flipping ridiculous. That store is awful. is. Yeah.
I mean, obviously, we don't know what the prices of decorations are going to be yet in the game, we can't say it's going to be like not like ESO, but I'm assuming it won't be like ESO.
It's a wonderful thing for them to raise revenue, like for the game, and I'm here, I'm there for it. Just sell us things that we can buy and put in our things.
And I think it's also really important that they, I think, outline some things immediately, both in the article and in this video, to I think kind of soothe some of those fears that this could be something that would be a really draining financial thing. Now, don't get me wrong. Honestly, I would be fine if they were going to add paid houses later on, because I know in Guild Wars 2, the house would not cost me 150 real dollars.
Right, exactly.
And it would be something where, again, because I'm not paying an optional sub, and I've paid, or I'm not paying an optional or mandatory sub, right? Because ESO has an optional but not so optional sub. 14 has a mandatory sub. Like, so again, because you're not paying that extra money, and because the expansion's themselves, and the expansion that we are getting this feature in, which is staggering in all the stuff they're adding into it alone, without the other actual content of the expansion, is like $30. So again, it's one of those things where
isn't it 25?
Yeah, it's like 25, 30
it's
bucks.
It's even less. It's like, oh my god.
So again, it's one of those things where they told us in the article that even though it sounds like there will be furnishing items that you can purchase in the Black Lion Trading Company, that you will immediately get multiple copies of that that'll just go into your like bank, and that you will get a recipe that you can craft infinite numbers of housing items from. So there's that, and whether or not they decide to actually put houses in the cash shop, it does seem very likely in the past, looking at how they've tackled guild halls and other things, that we will be getting more homesteads in the future. I would assume that would be themed in different regions, would come with expansions, or even if they were an optional purchasable thing, I have no doubt they would give us a lot of stuff for that. And that, again, because the rest of the game isn't charging us bunches of stuff for things, it's one of those costs where I'm like, I would feel a lot better about dropping, you know, whatever they want me to pay for a house if the whole expansion costs $25 and they release a house in the future for, I mean, I can't imagine that they would charge us an obscene amount for it, right?
So 2,000 gems.
2,000 gems or something.
Oh, I'd say like 4,000 or 5,000.
4,000 gems? Okay, that's fair.
That seems more reasonable for an entire life.
If amount is 2,000 gems,
yeah,
I suppose.
Yeah, if amount's 2K.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, yeah. I mean, the funny thing is, though, as well, with ESO and talking about subscription stuff, etc. If you have a subscription for ESO, the item limit of the house or the hall or whatever you've bought actually goes up. So you have a base level, and if you don't have a sub, it actually limits the amount of space you can have in the house, as far as I remember. Really, Geek or Rylus can probably remind me if that's not true. I'm pretty sure the case.
Jebro, you were on a still of the video just a second ago where he was
showing us. Yeah, I was gonna
over those little houses.
Yeah, so I'm gonna show. Okay. I'm gonna show you folks. So this is like the stable home that you get. And then, like, these are kind of examples of what they've built in there so far. And this is just what the ArenaNet folks built to show the writer. And this is
so
all
that was it. We discussed
flooring and, like,
last
just
time
panels
we were talking, we discussed it. And I brought up a few concerns because I was a little worried when they said that there's a structure that's there and then you get to decorate it. Mm-hmm. But then I forgot that, like, I didn't forget, but I didn't realize that you'd have so many options of decorations, and it, like, they listed the ways you could do things with decorations that is just like monumental compared to what you could do in a guild hall even.
I mean, look at this structure on the screen right now. There was literally a lighthouse, like they've out of columns and walls, and just it looked like this is end game content, right? I'm not
the question, one question I have,
it's the whole thing.
Is there gonna be a decoration limit?
Yes, there's a it's 1,000 items we saw on there, but I think it's 800 at the moment, according to the article in the video. Yeah,
Oh, okay. Wait, they actually announced the numbers? I didn't realize.
Yeah, there was number in the crafting thing as well, like for storage. And he actually mentioned it, I think. Let me just put you on the camera. I'll go and find it. I did a video.
Actually, because now we're in the portion of the podcast that Fornax and I can engage with. Fornax, yeah. How do you feel about this housing system that they've announced?
I'm very happy. I've been hoping for them to do this for quite some time. I have bored you all to tears requesting this feature.
Oh, no, you have not been boring. This is like, I'm here for this.
You're in it.
100%. Like, this is the biggest feature I've been looking forward to for a long time. So I'm with you.
I watched the PC gamer video. I was very happy. Watched it. Very interesting. I haven't seen those little arrows since I tried to teach myself Maya, which is lovely. That's a terrifying program. I love it. I love the they've just kind of decided to let the brakes off, let people have this feature. It be fun. It be creative. And funnily enough, I've just experienced the best housing system in any game that I've ever played with another game.
Did you say Palia, is it? Palia.
It is Palia. Yeah. Oh, it has the most phenomenal housing system with such freedom and such abilities. It is absolutely beautiful. You can grow flowers, you can treat it's just amazing. So I am very interested to see how Guild Wars stacks up against this. But I will, to be clear, like, the end game for Palia is basically this. The housing system, this kind of New Horizons type of Animal Crossingness that you get with building these multiple plots that you can have. And the housing system is really beautiful. So I'm looking forward to, and I'm hoping that Guild Wars can live up to that. So it's great. It's something that I really enjoy doing. I found it super meditative to kind of just make beautiful places to explore.
I need to get you on a weekly stream, Fornax, to show you other survival games where you can do exactly what you're doing, Palia. I swear, I need to like take you on an adventure because I flipping love house. So I just want to correct myself. I don't remember the limits. What the number, as Rita said, rightfully so, is the actual amount of items you can craft that was in my head. So it was 300 on the start, and it's 800. Yeah. They want to get to 800 different items that you can. I think in the video they did mention a number roughly. I'm not sure. Maybe they didn't. But like,
1,000 does seem like a lot of decorations.
But they are gonna have a limit. They have to have a limit.
There is probably going to be a limit. I don't remember them disclosing the exact number.
I do remember them
saying that you're going to start with 300 when the game launches, and then they will continue to add more and more decorations that you can use. On top
it's interesting,
of
that video,
jump store stuff.
Yeah,
it feels like that video, because when we were discussing Homesteads last time, we had a lot of questions. It feels like that video answered every single one of those questions, like, in a row of what we were asking.
This is why this video is so good, right? Like, because it is, like, look at the crafting system. Look, and also, can I petition to keep it as handiwork workbench? Because I just like the name of the craft. It's cool, like, it's their working title, I know, but, like, I kind of like handiwork workbench.
Handiwork is cute. Yeah. I mean, yeah, this video gave us an incredible preview into what we're going to be doing, right? I mean, I was blown away by the fact that you can, one, free place items anywhere. That's a basic hope in all games, but not all games have it. So being able to free place them is big enough. And then on top of that, the fact that you can actually scale the size of those objects up or down, taking a note from Wildstar, where that was something that was hugely popular to be able to do, so that, you know, if you have something that's like a cool decorative piece, you can make it really big, or you can make it really small, or you can add it into other stuff. Then to also have that x-ray vision mode, so that as you're clipping things into each other and you're moving them up and down, you can actually see them. Yeah, Boots, I saw you raise your hand. Yes, you may speak.
Because they also have those weapon, and you can make a statue of yourself and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Can you scale those as well?
The statue you can. Yeah, I don't know if you. I don't think.
But those, like, you have a gigantic gigantic eternity or something like that. If
I imagine you can, because I think every single asset that you place has the ability to be scaled and positioned in the way that you want it to be. So we could have like, and it's not just legendary, so we could actually have like a giant Balthazar sword like they have in Secrets of the Obscure in that like desert.
A giant Logan picture.
I don't know about armor and stuff though. Would it be like the resolution and stuff might be better? I don't know about that. I'm not sure if they
Well, they scaled the statue, so it's up to the player's discretion.
That's true. I mean, but again, like, that's another touch that just goes above and beyond, you know? You can, your alts can be in the whole instance, and you can populate them around. I mean, just the possibilities, like, not only do you get a bonus for your alts resting in the homestead, but think about the possibilities. Yeah, right? Like, think about the possibilities for role players and stuff, where if you want to make a whole bunch of characters to populate an area for an event, you want to have a ball, you want to have a whatever, right? You want to have NPCs, essentially, that your players could go up to without having to assign folks to be that NPC per se, right? Like, you can do that now. You could put those around.
You could pet your mounts.
You can pet your mounts and see them in a stable.
Yeah, it was in the beginning.
And you can place an NPC, one of your characters, your alts, onto the mount. And they can
That's
just be like
cool.
running around. And then if you want to get on that mount, you kick them off.
Did they say that you can put them on
the
mount?
NPCs to mount the mounts, but you can't mount your NPCs.
I didn't
the
hear mount, them say
no,
that.
No, you cannot. Well, they on the video, they come up to a mount and they kick their other character off of it.
Oh, is that what he said? Interesting. Yeah, okay, right. I need to see this again then.
Yeah. I'm very interested to see how you can place and maneuver your alts around. Because we saw them just dancing.
Dancing.
And I was like,
I hope they're not always dancing.
Yeah. I was like, I hope we could just like have them idle in this area or like idle fish near like a body of water.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, that'd be weird.
Or maybe naked mud wrestling for those that like that kind of thing. Oil them up and let them go.
Oh yeah, there was someone
the
on the mount.
The home instance.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there going to be a body oiling station in the furnishing?
Yes.
Jesus.
That was the one thing that we didn't. They didn't answer in that video from the questions we had in the last thing. Yeah. One of the questions we had: are we allowed to Sim style have intercourse between our NPCs?
You can't.
And they didn't answer that.
I think the rating of the game. I don't know.
Sims is teen.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I really love, Boots, how you had to, like, try to say that three times before you were able to bring yourself to do it. It was really
I had to held myself back a little bit.
You have been corrupted. Well, I think you've always been this way. I think you're just more free now to say the things you want to say.
Boots' homestead is just a giant picture with some tissues by the side of it. Yeah, absolutely.
Nargle Goldclaw exists in this game, so I'm just saying. But people have already pointed out a couple things in like the furniture lists that they showed in this video, that there does seem to be some kind of bookshelf. So will you be able to actually display your in-game books or collections?
I just want
to
put them somewhere, honestly, Rick. Put them somewhere that's not my bank, and I'll be happy.
And there was, somebody also noticed that there was a fish tank. So, you know, if we're thinking about like Final Fantasy XIV, there are fish tank items that allow you to display a variety of the fish that are catchable in the game. If you have caught them, you can then like put them into that tank. Will it be that interactable or will it just be a decorative fish tank? I mean, like, they could do whatever they want. Honestly, this whole system is already leagues ahead. And as I take a look at the stream now, although I'm sure there's going to be some delay just with how that works, the handy workstation, you know, the fact that scribing will be its own system still, and theoretically in guild halls, even though this decorating system is going to get sort of backported to guild halls, which is great, scribing will still be its own thing, which, like, I kind of wish that they had either tied these two in or like lessen some of the requirements on scribing, but I also understand that in theory a guild hall and some of the other stuff there, you know, you should have a guild or at least some collection of people that theoretically could help you with some of the mats and stuff that you might need. So I understand why they might still keep them separate. And it seems as though some furnishing items will go between, because we saw some roller beetle track pieces and stuff used in some of the decorations in the homestead. and you can use those in guild halls now. So again, like I don't know exactly how it'll work, but the homestead specific crafting, I'm really grateful that it seems as though it's going to be pretty accessible for everybody. You'll need to use some basic mats, and then you'll convert other excess mats that you have into some additional like specific homestead material kind of thing that you have to use for crafting. But I think this even incentivizes folks to do more with getting materials, to explore getting those nodes for their home instance and for homesteads. And I'm very happy that the cat collection and other stuff has been confirmed as showing up in your homestead, which really made me just say, Ran, I love it.
Well, I think that is the thing, right? Because someone said on one of my videos that basically it's going to really enhance the economy in the game as well. Because like you said, like people are going to have to go and get a ton of crap to convert into the currency, which is going to be used for crafting. And also, as you can see on your screen, it is, if you're watching the video, there's different fish as well. Like if you're going to make a fish tank, you have to get the fish to put in the fish tank. And it's like, is there different kinds of fish tank then? I guess that could be cool. But like if you see most of this is like all code and stuff, which makes sense. Like in the future, that could infer that there's just going to be non-specific stuff. There's going to be Asura-specific stuff. And then you can really make these places very unique. So it is very exciting how much stuff there is. There was a feature in here that was a brand new feature, which they're bringing in, which is going to be a harvest all as well, which looked very cool. Like just going over to a corner and it's just like, harvest all of the things, please. It's just like, that's so good. It's not coming out with it on release. It's a future thing, but it looks like they've pretty much fleshed that out by the looks of things.
The question I have is, so are they going to have homestead drops specifically in the only in Janthea Wilds content, or do you think, and I hope, that they open it up so that we have items specifically for the homestead dropping throughout the content loot tables of all of the game, and they could be specifically, so if you want vanilla items for your home, you have to go to vanilla content, Heart of Thorns, etc. I would love that. But do you think that they will do that?
Did they say, I can't remember in the video if they said, I mean, I think they said you're going to be able to get drops from like content, like raids and stuff. I think they should just do it maybe in the future, but like focus on mostly having it around the expansion so they can really encourage people. But I mean, it really depends, right? Like maybe they could add from one of the raids, like you can get trophies of all the boss, we've only got trophies, like you can take a part of them or something and put in your instance or something, or you can take a chair from like the, you know, from Wing 4 or something. I don't know, but that would be cool.
It could be a really fun event that they run after this expansion is technically over and we're in that waiting period where they then go back and unlock certain assets from these dungeons, these raids, and even like open world events like in Orc Base and Dragon Stand for players to gain new elements from this older content. It would further incentivize this evergreen nature that Guild Wars 2 innately is, but infuse something so monumentally cool in terms of incorporating it with the new homestead features. So I would love to be able to get like chunks of bloodstone geode rocks to create this bloodstone island somewhere, or Gorsival, and get like some spirit walls and create like a maze in your homestead or something. And you could just do some cool stuff. And I think with assets in particular that they already have, it's just a matter of reusing, and hopefully be too much of a burden if they ever do decide to go back and add some of those older assets to homesteads.
Do you think they would allow, like they just recently updated for guild halls, would they allow PvP to be turned on in homesteads? So you could design a fun mini game or something in your own homestead.
Yeah, that'd be super cool. I love all these ideas. And I mean, honestly, the fact that they went so above and beyond with this homestead system makes me hopeful, so hopeful, because I think it would have been really easy for them to just be like, yeah, here's the thing, and you can put some stuff in. But
yeah. Like,
they didn't true. Just do that. And honestly, it was kind of shocking to me because
I think,
for not because of just Guild Wars 2, but because of the greater MMO landscape, where it seems like more and more in a lot of games, I've just kind of been having to accept that, oh yeah, they'll probably just give us some kind of bare minimum, and then that's what we'll get.
No expectations.
Yeah, and it's funny because that's not to say that games aren't innovating and coming out with a lot of cool stuff, but it does seem like a lot of the really creative, innovative, big new features, a lot of companies just like aren't doing them as much anymore. And then you get some who are, and you get to see cool new ideas and systems. I mean, coming even like WoW has some interesting ones coming with their new expansion. And Guild Wars 2 coming in here with this housing system where they were like, we're really going to make this a feature of the expansion. And I would have paid them $25 alone just to unlock homesteading, you know, without any expansion attached to it, let alone to have a whole X pack with all of the content included as well. So if they do, and I really hope they do, expand out so that all the portions of the game could give you furnishing items, or if they introduce, like we were even talking about, a homestead that's acquirable earlier on in the game, that's from like one of the starting areas or something as well, so that new players could get into this system too. I think it would just be so great, and it would continue to circulate players through old maps. It's one of the things I always loved about in ESO. All kinds of stuff and all kinds of containers have the possibility of having recipes for different furnishing items in them. And so me as a person who, if given the opportunity, loots every single jar, nook, crevice, cranny, box, anything in a room, if there's a reason for me to, it felt like a delightful little, oh, hey, you do get this. So even just making old materials have new purpose from different zones, or, you know, the possibility of a variety of content dropping recipes or specific items.
We're using the many hundreds of currencies we have to actually buy stuff with it.
Dungeon shards. Yeah.
True, yeah. You could revisit your old currencies by having things related to those currencies be sold through those currencies.
Imagine the dungeons. Like you said, like buying stuff from the dungeons, and like dungeon starts playing the content again. And or even dare I say it, and I know it's difficult, I know it's hard, I know we all feel very strongly about this, dragon response missions. Do we want that? Ugh. I'm not sure. But still, I'd play it if I was going to get a sandwich that is very unique for my table and for my plate. I will do it. I don't care.
Do you guys think that it would be apt if, when we have our homestead and we decorate it, every once in a while the shopkeep from Super Adventure Box comes by and smashes all our vases?
Oh my gosh.
Well, in the ESO, you can get NPCs from the game, and they will sit in your house and they will say and do different things in your instance. So I wouldn't say that's beyond the realm's possibility. I mean, you know, like if there's a festival on, maybe there's a festival vendor like person in your house. But look at the amount of stuff you can. I was trying to peer a little bit more into the corners and stuff of what's going on. There's catapults, there's trebuchets, and like tons of skiffs. It's not just, I know you can have your skiff in there, but there's tons of skiffs on the left-hand side in this video, like top left. And then there's actually like the Lion's Arch Lion, the old one from base Lion's Arch.
Decoration.
Like as a decoration.
Oh yeah, with the whoop.
But look, the little lions as well. And even there's a smaller one over there. And then it looks like they've made, in this instance, they've made like a, are these the airships? Or they're like the sails from
That's
ships?
That's like a char.
That looks like an arena.
Looking
That's
arena.
An arena. Yeah. They've made an arena. Oh, that's sick.
I think I see
and
a net.
There are trebuchets as well. And I'm wondering if those are usable trebuchets.
That's true.
From a PvE player. The one thing I always ask for, even like in guild halls, was like a decoration that's a damage training dummy or a healing training dummy, so I can go to a location in PvE and just test out builds and try out rotations and just like, I think Guild Wars 2 is like the one game where we don't have PvE training dummies.
Oh
that
my
we can
god!
Like actually hit.
Elder Scrolls
that's
Online.
So true. That's so true.
You can buy different. You can unlock and buy different training dummies to do exactly that in your housing instance.
They could sell cultural, like, training targets on the gem store. Like, you have
you
a Suragon.
You just hit the hell out of Bram. Bram is in your instance, and he's an NPC. And, like, he's sending it. Oh, yeah, they're enemies. Like, they're a big, like, creatures and monsters.
That'd be fun, that you can, like, set up an arena and you can, like, fight NPCs. You can, like, fight Kaith and Ritlog. I would do that as a PV player.
Of
if
course.
I was in the gem store, I would drop 1,000 gems to, like, purchase the Dragon's Watch bundle, and you can choose to fight all of these NPC characters.
That'd be fun.
I think one of the important things about this video is it kind of showed me how much bigger the Homestead area is than I thought it was going to be from the original picture.
True. Yeah.
It's big. It's big. I didn't think there was going to be water in an ocean, you know, in it as well.
I'm thinking that I was right. You poo-pooed the fact that they showed us that Homestead area. You said,
know?
Oh, no, that's a ridge, that's a thing. And I'm like, I thought that was our island.
It could be. Yeah, the screenshots that they were showing leading up to this video, I was like, oh, it seems like pretty quaint. Maybe you can go up near the waterfall, like do some cool geography stuff with like placements of tiles. But no, they actually expanded this. You can really do I was not expecting the size to be this forgiving.
Exactly. And like the expectation is the thing. So I have paused it on a specific item, which is that big dragon head. And not only can you increase the size of it, but it looks like even the eyes you can move in different directions. Like,
I think he added the eyes.
Yeah, he
did. He add
them,
the eyes, or just did, or no, they parts of the actual thing as well.
Yeah, he's basically copying and pasting.
Oh yeah, sorry, there's eyes there.
Something inside, yeah.
And at that point,
oh, okay,
they say you can
fair.
Like copy and paste the data of an item and just
that's
duplicate
cool.
it.
Oh, I thought, you could adjust the individual parts of it, and I was like, damn, I'm getting super excited.
Well, I mean,
you can,
because you can just clip stuff into it freely.
That's true.
And, I mean, some of the things we haven't even mentioned, a small touch. Yes, the bee! A small touch, but a huge touch, which is the bee. So, in a lot of games that even have great housing systems, they don't have this. And, you know, earlier, Fornax, you mentioned, like, Minecraft when we were kind of coming in. And this was something that reminded me a lot of Minecraft creative mode. Mm-hmm. Where it seems like such a simple thing, but allowing a free flight decorating perspective is massive. Because the amount... I honestly don't... I know we've seen some other things in chat, like Lord of the Rings Online has a great housing system and stuff like that. So there are a couple that I don't know how they measure up with their housing systems, but with all the MMOs that I have played, they do not have this feature. So they are basically all...
You have to create
all...
structures to get up higher most of the time. In survival games, you have like an overall view and you can do different things. And there are... But not in MMORPGs. Like, you can't... Like, there's no, as far as I remember, there's no overhead. I think, and if in the ESO, I think you can do it, but you need to actually install a mod to do it. So that's not like base game. So you're right.
Yeah, this is great. This is brilliant. And I think that just makes it even more user friendly. And I mean, the big thing here for me with how big this guild hall is, or guild hall, this homestead is that I hope that it seems like from what we have witnessed with the things that they previewed, that they were still able to create a lot of structures, a lot of detail, a lot of items, a lot of things inside the homes and outside of the homes. So I have hope that the item limit will be fairly generous, because one thing that I did oftentimes feel with ESO is that they would have really huge mansion, manor level homes that you could get. But then the item limit would be restrictive enough that if I really were to decorate that space fully and with abandon, like, I would need triple the amount. And so I found myself sometimes being like, oh, it's really cool that we have this huge house, but like, I have to be so picky and choosy and sparse with what I'm going to put down. But it looks like the Guild Wars 2 system is going to be a bit more forgiving. And I'm hoping that is the case. We'll have to actually see, because I mean, servers and stuff, that is a real problem.
That's
but
that's the one there.
I'd like to be able to just go ham on it and decorate
that's
wildly.
It's server side, as far as I know that in ESO, when I talked to some of the devs, it was like a server side thing as well. Because when you start adding different materials and bags, and like you think about all the items that get added to bags every day and guild tabs and etc. etc. Like, it's a lot, but this is an instance with individual items, and it's so I'm like, but maps have this stuff and they're very well populated, and I'm like, I wonder how. But I know they're kind of, they're stuck there. They're not like, you know, I mean, they can move them, et cetera, et cetera. But they haven't got to like program the fact that people are going to come along and do all this different stuff. So I don't know how that works. But I think one thing that is good about limits is it enhances creativity to a degree as well, because it makes you think about what you're placing and where a little bit more, and how maybe... I think it adds another element to the process. I think you need to have a lot, but I think a limit is good to a degree, but like, I feel like it's going to be huge. I mean, look at the things they've created just in that instance there. There's like 3 or 4 houses. If you think about how much there's stuff like goes into houses. That. Yeah. That's like loads.
Is there a limit to the amount of people that you're allowed to invite into your homestead?
I don't know.
Oh, that's a good question. Because you can invite players, you can invite your friends, and they can actually help decorate if you allow them to. Mm-hmm. Maybe like a squad? I don't know.
No idea. Good question. Tweet it to what's his name. Maybe a lower answer.
I also just noticed that it has an Astral Ward waypoint. Now I'm like, but what if I want to change my waypoint to a different waypoint?
Maybe have what to craft
if I want? What if I want to craft like a normal waypoint because it's more like rustic? Or what if I want to do a jade tech waypoint because like they're going to be selling waypoint skins in the gem store?
Sure. I mean, why the hell not? I mean, let's go.
You think they're going to allow portal decorations? Like you buy a decoration that's a portal to a specific town?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, get like a Nasura one or whatever.
With a bookshelf keeping all the lore tomes and lore books. Having some type of like home portal where you can put all of your teleport tomes into that, and you can just like easily select through all of them.
Oh, that'd be so good.
You can also use the teleport portals that you get to from Addition. You can use the teleport windows at Mirror. Mm. So, yeah,
handy so to get that.
There's so much possibility. This is going to be
a decoration that's a visual in-game representation of the world boss response thing item you get.
Oh, that'd cool. That'd be really fun.
That's nice. I like that idea. You can do things from your... I think they're probably going to be very cautious about being able to do so many things from your home instance, because I know that then that takes away from the actual MMO people running around to cities thing. And they've already got so many cities, right?
Fair enough.
They do have to be careful.
But you can craft, can't you? Didn't they say you could craft?
Yeah.
Is it only crafting
your own decorations, though?
I see what you're saying.
Oh, yeah, I don't know if it's gonna be like crafting stations.
In ESO, have you ever visited a crafting instance? Oh my god. In ESO, you can craft pretty much most of the armor, but then you need a different table for different dungeon sets of armor and different boss specific sets and stuff. So you can go into guilds and they will have like the alphabet laid out in the air, and they'll have tables like I'm talking about like 50, 60, maybe hundreds actually of different crafting tables, so that you can go to a different table to craft the exact thing you need. And it's wild. Like people would just add other people just so they can go to their instance and craft from their instance because they've got something special there, and just all of these different facilities. It's actually really cool. I forgot about that. Mm-hmm. That's wild. That is actually pretty nuts.
Honestly, I don't think that if they cared about like maintaining the populations and the cities, they wouldn't have introduced the various lounges that they have, would they?
That's true. They've got all these lounges. That's right. That's very true.
Even the arboreal place in Path of Fire, where we built up so that we could have crafting stations, I can see that being part of the mastery, so that we can have this unique place of our own to be private or with friends or just for guildies or whatever, you know.
That was what they were trying to do. They were trying to do something like that with that, weren't they? What is it? What's the place called? The Sunspin.
Yeah.
Do you think it's a wise...
I'm talking about the other one as well, the old one. Sun's Refuge. Yeah. That was meant to be like something around that, I think. I think there was maybe a thought or feeling around there, but...
I guess the question is, do you think it's a wise economic move for them, and or do you think they're worried about it being a wise move to introduce all of the benefits,
it's gonna be good.
All of the benefits of a hub into the homestead, if it means that they wouldn't buy new hubs or amenities in the future?
You can guarantee there is not going to be a trading post. So I feel like that will keep pushing people out towards those places.
Maybe, because if maybe they decide not to make any more lounge passes and instead to sell different plots of land, I could see them adding where you have to craft or enlist certain merchants to come to your homestead so you can place them there and have
access. Can you imagine if people could, you could... walk people around your instance and they could purchase it or something, and you could like a real estate agent or something. I know they won't do that, but like it's just ridiculous. But one, there was actually a really good suggestion and comment on one of my videos, is that if you can, that, and this is, bear in mind, this is really good, this would be ridiculously complicated, but they were talking about, you know how you can share codes for your builds? What if you could share a code for your home instance where all of the items are, and it would just copy it? And I was just like, I would actually genuinely love that. Like, I know it would be ridiculous. But like, you can, because in ESO technically,
that must be possible.
You can do, well, in ESO you can do, you can buy a house that's already furnished. So it pre-comes with everything placed, and then you can just move it. So in a way,
that's how it's saved, right? Like your homestead must have a long string of information on where all the decorations are, and that's how it's saved. So that must be able to be copied over in some way.
Question:
who knows if it's like possible?
Would it be possible? Would it be possible rather than to sell them? Because I think that would be just wow. But perhaps you could have, like, we have different build loadouts for our builds, different loadouts. So this is my summer house, and this is my winter house, and this is the house that I've made.
Oh, so we just have it for us personally?
I also have this question, because this is an account-bound system, so it's not like every single character will start with a fresh home instance.
True.
So my guess is that for this one, you're only ever going to have one version of it.
Yeah.
And maybe in the future, if they add more plots of land, then you would have the option to have it be a separate entity and you start completely fresh. So that was one thing I was, you know, interested by, because it is account bound, like so many things in Guild Wars 2. But I'm wondering, like, what if this character that I have would decorate it in a different way, and so on and so forth. So maybe would they sell like save slots for this?
Maybe. I mean, they did it for builds. They could do decoration templates.
That's true. But I think an entirely new plot of land would be more exciting.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's just lore-wise, right? Like, you actually feel like this is your homestead. This other place is your second house, etc.
They could do both.
Yeah.
And...
I mean, they have revealed that items that you buy on the gem store for the house are going to be in multiplicity, that there'll be as many as you want to spawn rather than traditional items, which you have to craft as many as you wish to place.
They did say there will be copies.
A lot of utility.
I don't know if it's unlimited or not. I'm not sure.
I thought I heard that they will give you a good amount,
and then they'll give you a recipe to make more.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
So maybe 5 to 10 of like a certain item, and then
So then technically you would be able to. I wonder if that would then apply to the space that you would have a limit to if you bought the items. I would imagine so, right?
Oh yeah.
Or would it be different because you purchased them? I don't know. That might be a bit cheeky.
This is a big system to be implemented into the game, and it's going to create so much more endgame content for players. And I hope that it does interconnect to things like raids and dungeons, maybe even fractals and open world meta events. Because I will be playing Homesteads, but I'm still a PvE player at heart, and I want to go and collect those decorations. Maybe not when it launches, but later down the line.
Absolutely. Like it just... In ESO, there's like some really rare drops from like different places where people will get like, I can't remember what it's called. It's like, it looks like a small little beehive, but it's just not a beehive. It's like a circular light, and there are different lights you can get from different bosses and lamps and stuff. And like they combine them into these things. I just go like, if you ever like anyone watching, just go and look at some of the things that people create in Elder Scrolls Online. It's ridiculous. Like, people create power armor from flipping, like, you know, Fallout and stuff. Like, they could. I think there is a. All right, okay, I'm finding it right now. There is literally like the Death Star and stuff. Like, I'm gonna put this up in the background for like awesome builds. But you can create some ridiculous stuff in that game. And I'm just excited to see. I mean, the funny thing is because this system exists, potentially, like, because this system is going to exist, it's going to draw people from other MMOs that have housing systems. Like, it's going to legitimately do that. There's no way that it can't. Like, I mean, here you go. This is a really, really good one. Wait, why is everyone at Jebro?
Check chat. Us trying to do this.
We know you get lost in the sauce.
TikTok, darling. TikTok.
Oh, is it the time? Oh, yeah. We've got like seven minutes until 2 hours. Like seven.
Yes.
We have 1 minute.
Oh, really? All right. Sorry. Okay. We're going to end it. I'm just going to show you this one picture. And then we're going to. This is one example, and it's just one of the first ones I came across, and it's not like ridiculously awesome, but it's pretty damn cool. And it's just like this big kind of crew, like it looks like something from Elden Ring.
Looks like Howl's Moving Castle.
Yeah, basically.
That is literally Howl's Moving Castle.
Yeah, I was like, that looks so familiar.
Yeah. So that is one thing that, like, and it's probably a house, like it's a house in that you would definitely go in there and do the things. Like, it's ridiculous. So,
Mayo Kazumi.
Thinking. Yes. Enjoy. It's going to be wicked. And we're going to have more podcasts about this as soon as we find out more information. And I want them to give me a beta for this. Even if it's a small amount of stuff.
We are not getting a beta for this.
Let me test it. I want to. Let me do it. Maybe we'll get the dev on for this. I've been, like, tweeting about him and stuff.
Ooh.
That would be very cool. And the team, maybe some people. Either way, exciting times as we get towards Jamfear Wilds. I don't think we're going to have a podcast next week because it is going to be July the 4th for Americans. So I think most people are probably going to be on holiday or doing something anyway. So we might skip next week unless they bring out something ridiculous. probably right.
Independence Day for all the Brits as well. So yay.
Yeah. It could be. Have you seen John Oliver's video? Oh my God, you need to go watch that.
Yes.
Oh my God. It will be our Independence Day. It's just like, this is so good. So maybe the Independence Day for the UK on July 4th as well from the Tories, who are interesting people.
Fingers crossed, darlings. Yes.
We'll see. So good luck in the UK, fellow Brit people. And otherwise, Fornex, tell us what you do, where you live.
Hey, I'm Fornex, the Crichton Herald. I make content over on YouTube and occasionally stream here on Twitch. Please look out for a video coming. I'm doing a big home tour of my Palian house, talking about housing and talking about all the new systems and introductions that have been brought in. The game is still in beta, but really developing fantastically. And I'm really looking forward to diving into the Guild Wars 2 housing and comparing the two, because honestly, peak housing for Palia So yeah, please do keep an eye on the channel. That's going to be out in the next couple of days. And I'm going to do a bit of a lore dive into Guild Wars 2's Janthea Wilds as well, for people who don't know about the lore of the Bloodstones and the Eyes and the Chosen and all that bit. But of course, I've already made those videos if you want to check them out on the Flameseeker Prophecy. But yeah, that's nice. Me over on YouTube. Please check it out.
Wicked. Kruf, how are you?
Hello, everyone. I have just released a new video talking about all of the 9 profession skills and how they interact with the spear and my overall impressions. So if you'd like to go check that out, you can head over to my YouTube channel, @Kruf. I also stream here on Twitch on the weekends, and you can follow me on Twitter and everywhere else. Thank you for having me.
Wicked. Thank you so much. Boots.
Hello. I am Boots. You can find me at World Avengers on YouTube, and I've been doing a lot of adventures recently, but they're kind of all done until new stuff comes out, so I am going to be taking a little bit of a break, I think, taking care of the babe, and then we'll see what happens after that. But, so, yeah.
Good times. Big things happening. Rookery, and you?
Yep, I am Rookery. You can find me on Twitch at Rookery. That's R-O-O-K-U-R-I. You can find me on YouTube at the same, and you can find me on Twitter at Rookery _. Tomorrow, you can also find me, depending on when you watch this, it will be 6/29, so June 29th, depending on when you hear watch. I will be live over on Team Liquid's channel. I'm going to be hosting the second half of the Eve Ascension tournament that's happening. It's starting at 11 a.m. CT, and it's an awesome, awesome tournament in esports that is all played by, cast by, and largely produced by women and non-binary folks. So it's definitely worth the watch. And of course, right now I'm super deep in Dawn Trail since it literally just went into early access. So if you're coming by and you're hyped about Janthea Wilds, don't worry too much. I'll be releasing YouTube videos on, you know, Dawn Trail playthrough stuff, and I'll be doing some non-spoilers Dawn Trail streams. But of course, as we get closer and closer to Janthea Wilds and Guild Wars 2 in August, the exact same is going to happen. So we'll be doing a lot of content for both of the games and getting hyped about all this amazing content that we have coming up as we celebrate some special events along the way.
Epic. If you want to follow the podcast, youtube.com/JebroUni, you can find out all the episodes are there. These normally come out on a Saturday morning Pacific time, about like 7:30 a.m. So bright and early America side of things, but a little bit later in the day for EU. Twitch.tv/JebroUni on a Friday, 1 p.m. Pacific-ish. Not next week though, to around July 4th, because probably having a break. Also, if you want to check it out on Spotify, etc., etc., you can do that. You can also check out myself when I stream on the weekends, twitch.tv/JebroUni as well. Otherwise, that has been Spears and Homesteads in 2 hours-ish, which is pretty damn good. So, excellent work, everyone. Thank you for telling me to stop. Because I would not have... if you hadn't told me. See you next time on Lightbringers
next
podcast.
Next time, our safe word will be banana. Yeah.
Okay.
Right. Banana.
We're just gonna have
banana cream pie.
We're gonna do a 24 hours Homestead stream talking about each item we think is gonna be in the gonna be available. Each one, and we're gonna draw it as well.
My brain disconnected.
Group transcended their body.
Excellent. No. All right, everyone. Thanks so much for watching. Take care.
Bye.
Bye for now.
Bye.